afternoon. You're welcome. On behalf of the family, as we come to celebrate the memory of Jerry and all the impact he's had on many of our lives, but also to worship the one who made it possible for him, and that is Jesus Christ today. So we're glad you're here. I'm sure memories are flowing in many of our hearts and minds, but yet we want to be able to leave this place today uplifted with the wonderful hope that we have in Jesus Christ. So God bless you as we worship together. Amen.
Thank you for being here, and welcome. The music we share with you and that you participate in will be hymns that Jerry really loved and wanted to be sung today. And also, it's music that has come out of our Swedish heritage. And so it means something to all of us who grew up in the Swedish Covenant Church, and maybe some of you did. So I'm going to ask you to stand. And we're going to sing one of Jerry's favorites, Day by Day and With Each Passing Moment. Day by day and with each passing moment, strength I find to meet my trials here. Trusting in my Father's wise bestowment, I've no cause for worry or for fear. He whose heart is kind beyond all measure gives unto each day what he deems best. Lovingly, it's part of pain and pleasure, mingling toil with peace and rest. Every day the Lord himself is near me, with a special mercy for each hour. All my cares he fain would bear and cheer me, he whose name is Counselor and Power. The protection of his child and treasure is a charge that on himself he laid. As your days, your strength shall be in measure, this the pledge to me he made. Help me then in every tribulation, so to trust your promises, O Lord, that I lose not faith, sweet consolation offered me within your holy word. Help me, Lord, when toil and trouble meeting, e'er to take as from a Father's hand. One by one, the days, the moments fleeting, till I reach the promised land. Remain standing for the scripture call to worship. Thank you.
The call to worship is printed in your bulletin there. You will read the bold-faced type. I will read the other type. The eternal God is your dwelling place, and underneath are the everlasting arms. You will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. Jesus said, You may be seated. I am not the Reverend Peter Thompson. I am the Reverend Brad Kindall. Peter Thompson, Jerry's son-in-law, sadly, came down with the flu, and so I am pinch-hitting. I would like to read with you to you a short biography of Jerry's life. Gerald Donald Kindall was born on May 27, 1935, to Harold and Alfield Kindall in St. Paul, Minnesota. He grew up in the middle of a large Swedish extended family. His Swedish heritage richly influenced his life. He is survived by his brother, Wayne Kindall, of Phoenix, Arizona, and Reverend Merrill Kindall of Blaine, Minnesota. Jerry graduated from the University of Minnesota, where he earned his Bachelor of Science degree in English and Master of Arts degree in physical education. While at Minnesota, he earned two varsity letters, each in basketball and baseball. In 1956, Kindall was All-American shortstop on the Gopher NCAA championship team that beat Arizona in the College World Series title game. While attending the University of Minnesota, Jerry met Georgia Nelson, and they were married in November of 1956. Jerry and Georgia had four children: Betsy Thompson of Bishop, California; Doug Kindall of Sacramento, California; Bruce Kindall of Phoenix, Arizona; and Martha Collins of Pleasant Hill, California. In June 1956, Kindall signed a bonus contract with the Chicago Cubs. He played 8 years as an infielder in the big leagues with the Cubs, Cleveland Indians, and Minnesota Twins, with 1965 American League champion Twins his last year before retiring from pro ball. Kindall joined the Minnesota athletic staff in 1966 as assistant basketball coach, and in 1968 assumed double duty as assistant baseball coach. On February 1st, 1972, Kindall left Minnesota and took over the Arizona baseball program from retiring Frank Sansett. Arizona baseball gained an international flavor under Kindall's guidance. The Wildcats toured Holland, Germany, Italy, and Taiwan. Kindall coached and gave clinics in Europe, Taiwan, South America, Aruba, China, Latin America, as well as in over 40 states in the United States. In 1987, Georgia, Jerry's wife of 30 years, died of Lou Gehrig's disease. The following year, Jerry married Diane Sargent of Colorado Springs, Colorado, on November 25th, 1988. Diane, widowed in 1987, also has two children, Rod and Elise. Jerry and Diane have six children between them and 12 delightful, kind, loving, beautiful, accomplished grandchildren. After 24 years as head baseball coach at Arizona, Jerry Kindall retired August 1st, 1996. He stepped down after becoming the winningest coach in the history of the University of Arizona with 861 victories. Among Kindall's coaching highlights are NCAA championships in 1976, 1980, and 1986. College Baseball Coach of the Year in the 1976, 1980, and 1986 years. NCAA Regional Finalist or Champion, 11 years advancing to the NCAA College World Series in Omaha five times. Head coach for the 1979 USA baseball team, in the Pan American Games held in Puerto Rico, and assistant coach for the 1991 USA team in the Pan American Games in Cuba and 1999 USA national team. Jerry authored the popular instructional book, Sports Illustrated Baseball, along with numerous magazine articles on baseball coaching and four instructional videos for coaches and players. He served as the editor of the Science of Baseball and co-editor of the current bestseller, The Baseball Coaching Bible. Jerry was inducted into the College Baseball Coaches Hall of Fame in 1991, the University of Minnesota Sports Hall of Fame in 1995, and the University of Arizona Sports Hall of Fame in 1996. In January 2004, the University of Arizona renamed the baseball complex Jerry Kindall Field at Frank Sansett Stadium. Since retirement, Jerry and Diane had the delightful privilege of traveling the world as Jerry taught and coached as a Major League Baseball envoy in Sweden in 2001 and 2002 and in France in 2003. Jerry lectured on the history and lore of baseball on 5 major cruise lines, lucky guy, on over 15 cruises. Jerry was a color analyst for college and Little League Baseball on ESPN, Fox, Big Ten Network, Pac-10 Network, and others. And Jerry also taught in the Elder Hostel Rhodes Scholar Program during spring training in Tucson and Phoenix for a number of years. Jerry received various awards over his baseball career, as we all know. But at the top of the list, and most meaningful, was in 2006 at the annual American Baseball Coaches Convention, when the Fellowship of Christian Athletes established the Jerry Kindall Character in Coaching Award. Jerry received the inaugural award for his, quote, example of what it means to be a coach of character. Each year, another coach who has exemplified exceptional character has been chosen to receive this award. Jerry had served for many years on the ABCA Ethics Committee, striving to encourage a high ethical standard among baseball coaches. Jerry was one of the past presidents of the American Baseball Coaches Association and currently was a member of the board of directors. Through the ministry of Young Life, Jerry became a believer in Jesus Christ during high school. Jerry was a very involved member of his church and various Christian organizations, especially those that minister to young people. And every one of us here today can probably tell a story about how Jerry Kindall has impacted our lives, perhaps from afar, but for many of us, from very intimate moments. Jerry Kindall lived an amazing life, a profound life, a significant life, and a joyful life. It was a life of great love. He loved his family, he loved baseball, and he loved Jesus Christ. And it brought him great pleasure to share all of those things with every one of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Brad. I've known Jerry all my life, and I've learned new things just from that. Wow. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, you who are our refuge, our strength, and our ever-present help, we pray that this afternoon you embrace all of us with that sense of your comfort and compassion and grace. That as we do remembering of one who was important to all of us, that, Father, we will hear more and more the power of your Holy Spirit speak to each of our hearts of what it is to know the same Savior as Jerry. Thank you for his family and their support. Thank you, Father, for the memories and the legacy that they bear from their father, husband, grandfather, great-grandfather, brothers, and others. We thank you, Father, that you have given us something to walk with as we remember the life of a man who touched us all. And so, Heavenly Father, we give you the praise for what has happened in his life and the praise for what you will do in ours as we trust you in all things. In your name we pray. Amen.
This next song we're going to sing is a song, again, and I can attest to this, absolutely one of Jerry's favorites. And very often, he would sing this song as we drove in that old Model A together that we used to transport ourselves back and forth to baseball practice and school and basketball practice. I absolutely loved this song. And I think it speaks to all the things that we have already discussed that involve his character and his love for the Lord. And I would ask you, as we sing these words, that maybe you can just interject the image and the name Jerry Kindall into each phrase and each verse, because that's what Jerry wanted. He wanted to be remembered as one who loved Jesus. My Jesus, I love thee. Please stand.
Jesus, I love thee, I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior, art thou. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. I love thee for wearing the thorns on thy brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I'll love thee. Say when the death dew lies cold on my brow, if ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. In mansions of and endless delight, I'll ever adore thee in heaven so bright. I'll sing with the glittering crown on my brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now.
Thank you. You may be seated. Remembering the life of Gerald Donald Kindall. We'll have Doug Kindall, his son, Carissa Forsyth, granddaughter, and Mark Johnson, friend, former U of A assistant coach.
Thank you, Wayne. My middle name is Wayne, and you know who I was named after. And it makes me very, very proud, not just to be the son of Jerry Kindall, but to be the nephew of Wayne Kindall and Merrill Kindall, and to be family with the wonderful people I see in front of me. Not just my immediate family, but the family I see out in the pews. So to friends old and new, to those I haven't yet had the privilege of meeting, I thank you for coming to celebrate the life of Jerry Kindall. And to honor his legacy as a man of God, loving husband, wonderful father, doting grandfather and great-grandfather, and outstanding athlete, coach, and teacher. You and so many others have reached out to our family with prayers, kind words, and remembrances of Dad. These have been such a comfort, and your love and support are greatly appreciated. Our loss has been tempered, knowing Dad has left us only in body, and that he is truly home, and we will meet him again in glory someday. We were blessed to have been by his bedside, crying, praying, singing hymns, sharing stories, and even laughing. As we said our goodbyes, and Dad was welcomed into the loving arms of his Savior. So, we celebrate a life well led. It's hard for me to put into words what Dad meant to me and to our family. His baseball accomplishments, both as a player and a coach, were extraordinary. We know that. And while we as a family are incredibly proud of these, what is as special to me as his son are the times spent just being with him on the ball field. Whether it was my brother and I serving as bat boys for various teams, traveling with and even playing in some games with the Wildcats on a trip to Europe in 1976, or helping with Wildcat baseball camps, seeing him in action has informed every aspect of my life. His discipline with compassion, his dedication to excellence with humility, and his respect and kindness to all those around him, in my opinion, are far greater achievements than victories, championships, and records. My fondest baseball memories are actually watching him teach my own three sons and their cousins, my nieces, my nephews, and all of their friends, not just the game of baseball, but the game of life. Say it with me if you know the words. Feet spread, seat down, hands in front, bring it through the funnel to the belly button. Those, my friends, are as good of a lesson and a instruction to big leaguers as they are to little leaguers. He gave free clinics all around the world and taught people the love of the game. And that's a really true legacy to me of just what he did for the game of baseball. While baseball, out of necessity, determined much of our family's schedule, our life was so much more than that. Our home growing up was filled with love, joy, laughter, and music. It's befitting that my sister, Betsy's middle name, is Joy. Much of that was the result of my dad's warm, loving spirit, regardless of the circumstances. We as teens were met and awakened most morning with his singing. And bear with me, I don't have Wayne's voice, but it usually went like this. This morning there's joy in my heart, even when it's cloudy or gray. This morning there's joy in my heart, every day's a wonderful day. While my 16-year-old ear did not want to hear that, and I wanted nothing more than to go to bed, back to bed, what a great way to greet the morning, and what an outlook on life. And the singing continued through bedtime, with Dad singing songs to us like Froggy Went A-Courting, or folk classics like Stewball, which you might have recognized was played by the band. He often accompanied his singing on the ukulele or the guitar. What a lot of people don't know is Dad had a beautiful voice. He would lead hymn sings at the little covenant church we went to. And while it was my mom who had the true musical talents, she was a wonderful pianist and organist, taught piano for many years, my dad had a passion and a love for music. And I think especially for hymns, we've recognized that with what we've sung today. And I think that heritage is beautifully exemplified with his grandkids playing the songs that were so meaningful to him. And I want to thank you all for that. Growing up, there was a plaque on the wall that hung above our kitchen table It simply stated the greatest thing a father can do for his children is to love their mother. Dad loved and honored our late mother, Georgia, so beautifully, and set an example for not just his children and his family, but for all people he came in contact with. His love and devotion to his children and his grandchildren was unending. Not a day went by that he didn't pray for each and every one of you by name. His compassionate care for my mom as she battled ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease, was the embodiment of a committed, loving marriage, and something that I will never forget. And after her death, God brought Diane into his life. And their love story these past 29 years is a thing of great beauty. Diane, you made Dad so happy. We are forever grateful for you and for the joy that you brought back into Dad's life after he had suffered so. We feel your pain deeply. We love you, and we will always be here for you. The thing I am most proud of is this. Jerry Kindall loved and served God. Corky Simpson, the longtime local sports writer and a dear friend of my dad's, wrote one of many recent beautiful tributes. This, I think, was in allsports.com, tucsonsports.com, something like that. It started with Corky relaying what my dad wanted on his epitaph. The simple phrase, he served God. This was not some recent proclamation that my dad made to Corky. I had heard that phrase so many times. I had had the privilege growing up of attending fathers and sons banquets with my dad and heard him share his testimony. And in that, he relayed and talked about the example of successful men who nonetheless had felt unfulfilled in their earthly accomplishments. He then gave the example of King David and how David had served God. And as stated in Acts 13:36, now when David had served God's purpose in his own generation, he fell asleep. He was buried with his ancestors and his body decayed. But the one whom God raised from the dead did not see decay. And that one raised from the dead was my dad's Lord and Savior, my Lord and Savior, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Love flowed out of Jerry Kindall. If you had ever met him, you knew that. Even if you hadn't, you knew it. And that love flowed out of the unending love that God had for Jerry, that God had for us. And there would be no greater testament for me to stand here and say what Dad would want most for all of us is for us to know that love and to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Thank you for coming.
Sammy Squirrel, he jumped out of bed, rubbed the sleep out of his eyes, ran from the bedroom through the kitchen to the living room, stuck his head out of the hole in the tree, and down there on the ground was his old friend, Barney Bear. The tales of Sammy Squirrel, Barney Bear, and their animal friends are legendary among the Kindall clan. From the time my mom, Betsy, and her siblings could walk, their dad would pull them onto their laps and fill their imagination with stories of Sammy, Barney, and their adventures in the forest, learning about friendship, honesty, and integrity, and love of family. Jerry's creative storytelling continued not only with my mom's three younger siblings and her, but with his grandkids as well. And many of you are here today, and you knew Jerry as a friend. Others called him coach, but I'm here speaking on behalf of the 12 of us grandkids that knew him as Papa. And what a Papa he was. From taking us to search for lost golf balls on the golf course near their home, to secret club meetings for the grandkids in their attic, visits with Papa were always full of joy and excitement. Papa and Grandma pulled out all the stops to make their grandkids feel special, loved, and to make sure we always enjoyed our time together. And when we were apart, Papa did all that he could to stay connected. This is gonna sound familiar. Though my college roommate wasn't too pleased, I was always happy to hear my dorm room phone ring at 7 a.m. on a Saturday morning because I knew Papa was the only one who called that early. I'd answer the phone to him singing, "It is morning, there's joy in my heart." He would then go on to ask if I was wearing socks because he considered it very important that my feet were warm. And after eagerly listening to the happenings of my life, every conversation with Papa ended with him telling me that he was proud of me, that he loved me, and that he prayed for me every day. And the thing is, I know that he really did. "I'll pray for you" is a phrase easily said, sometimes with little sincerity. But with Papa, when he told me that he was praying for me, I knew without a doubt that he was. Occasionally as a kid, if I woke up early enough, I'd walk into our living room to find my mom sitting with her Bible in her lap and praying. She does this every single morning. And once I asked her about this habit, and she told me that it was Papa who instilled in her the importance of praying for our loved ones. Papa leaves a legacy of faith that I will cherish my whole life. And while faith, integrity, and kindness are the first things that come to mind when I think of Papa, the way he shared his love of baseball and sports in general can't go unmentioned. Papa made me feel so special when he would take my sister and me onto the U of A baseball field before games. He introduced us to the players, he'd play catch with us, and spent time with us talking about the game. I was filled with such awe and pride that my Papa was such a beloved coach. That pride was amplified when our Papa, the legendary U of A coach, came to cheer us on in our own sports. He stood through many of my soccer games in the freezing Seattle rain to cheer me on. He drove all the way to LA to watch my sister run in her college regional cross-country meets. And I know my cousins can share similar stories. With Papa, it was clear he used sports as a means to love people and as a way to enter their story. Papa's own story is one that is worthy of telling. He put into action all of the moral lessons he taught in his Sammy Squirrel stories, exhibiting true friendship, honesty, integrity, and love for family. I will pass on these stories to my own son, and not only the stories of Sammy Squirrel, but the story of my son's extraordinary great-grandpa and the profound influence he's had on me and countless others. As Papa's children and grandchildren know, all Sammy Squirrel stories end with Sammy racing home after some grand adventure. He scurries into his tree in time for supper, just as the sun is setting. Today, as we grieve and we celebrate the sunset of Papa's life, we know that he, like Sammy Squirrel, has made it home safely.
I am honored to stand before you today as we acknowledge and we celebrate a friend of ours. A few days ago, I had sent an email to the Kindall family, just some thoughts about Jerry. And so Diane called and she said, would you read that at the funeral? And I said, if you would like me to, I would. And she made it very clear that she wants me to read it. I'm a coach, so if I get in the locker room pretty good and get going, she knows, so she knows me well. I can tell you how great Jerry was, but great is the most overrated single description word in athletics. There is so much more than the one loss record and the championships and the Hall of Fames. We can do better than that. His material achievements are tremendously exceptional, only belonging to a very elite groups in the baseball world. But that still isn't it. There is more to true greatness. Let's see if we can touch on a few more things that might get us closer to who and what he was. He was diligent, trustworthy, honest, loyal. He was sensitive. He was firm, and I kind of laugh at it because we got a lot of baseball players that played under Jerry. They know about firm, okay? And there may be some umpires that may have come today. And they also, if they dared to have a bad day with the Wildcats, they got to hear that firmness as well. He was fiercely competitive, and yet he had a great sense of humor. Jerry demonstrated to us how to treat our wives and our families. He listened well. He was a bold man of God, and I use the word bold because he was bold. You knew where he stood. You knew God's. He knew God's scriptures and its meaning, and he embraced efforts to follow God's calling. He was a fearless Christian leader in an athletic world. He was built on a solid rock of character. He turned boys into men. He turned men into men. And he was just a guy that was going to be a coach's coach and a gentleman's gentleman. And yes, he let God's light shine and bring God's love into the world. This man, this coach, this father, this grandfather, this husband, this dude, always could be found traveling the high road. I want to suggest that there's a final question to ask that bears the total truth without describing its total content. Ask this question of a coach. Ask this question of a coach. Yes, sir, do this and watch motion stop. Ask a coach who he wants to coach his son. I mean his son, his boy. Who do you want to leave with the coach? Jerry Kindall's name rises, and I would dare say would be the high rising name. That's a little bit better than the Hall of Fame. That's a little bit better than the one loss record. Jerry is, without question, one of my best and closest friend, and he would be a force that we would force him to have to stand on the highest pinnacle, but he would fall into that category because everyone would like their son to rub shoulders with him. We shared our love together. God sent him into my life. I prayed to work with a Christian coach when it wasn't very popular in 1973. God opened that door. Jerry taught me. He mentored me. He impacted me, and he loved me. And I would not be the same man I am today if it wasn't for Jerry Kindall. I will miss him, but I will carry a lot of JK with me, and I'm proud of that. I will do all I can to honor the privilege. It's called legacy, and a whole lot of folks here today are recipients of that legacy. He accomplished a lot in 82 years. Jerry was a very, very special man. When we were in his company, we were richer for the occasion. We were truly blessed. That memory, my friends, will last a lifetime for me. And oh yes, I'm going to finish with this one sentence. We are blessed. When Jerry and God got together, they hit a home run when they picked those two women out. God bless Jerry Kindall.
Thank you so much. Imagine there's many more stories that we can be telling out here than just those that we've heard. And aren't we grateful that that's the case? Many lives are touched. Was our family attending? Where did he go? Oh, there he is. Okay. he's deserting us here. We're at Brad's wedding out in Pepperdine University, and Jerry and Wayne and myself and our wives all went out for breakfast together. And while we're sitting there, he said, I've got something very special to show you. And so he picks out of his pocket some pictures. He said, I want you to meet Diane. I think I'm falling in love with her. Pray for us that we understand our relationship. And I guess I'll say, praise the Lord, that love did go all the way, both ways. And Diane has been very special to all of us in our home. We rejoice that we can be a part of her life as she is ours. She wrote a comment. It's in your bulletin. And I think it's appropriate for us to amplify this statement again as a reflection of Diane's thoughts and feelings, and I think of many of our own. He says, we all had our lives touched by Jerry in one way or another. Therefore, may we remember to thank his loving God who gave him his baseball skills and coaching ability, but much more importantly, made him the loving, caring man he was. Let us hear the word and song. And all of God's people said, amen. Thank you so much. Scriptures this afternoon were favorites of Jerry's as well as our whole family. And so I share them with you as sort of a focus of this service, but where we continue to go in this service. Some are very familiar. Some might be noon to you. But each of them have a profound statement to make to us. And so we begin in the Lord's name with the familiar Psalm 23, which many of you may be able to know by heart. And it reads, "The Lord is my shepherd, and I lack for nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He refreshes or restores my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Jesus says these words to us as the Good Shepherd. In John 10, "I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. But I have come that you might have life and have it to the full. I'm the good shepherd," says Christ. "And the good shepherd lays his life down for the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and my sheep know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay my life down for the sheep." Then out of Isaiah, the 43rd chapter, he writes, "Do not be afraid, for I have ransomed you. I've called you by name, and you are mine. And when you go through the deep waters, I will be with you. And when you go through the rivers of difficulty, you will not be drowned. And when you walk through the fire of oppression, you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you. For I am the Lord, your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior." And appropriate words for Jerry out of 2 Timothy 4. "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award me on that day, and not only to me, but to all who love his appearing." May the Lord bless his word to us. I think in that we were touched by heaven. What good news that was. Well, if you haven't figured it out by now, I'm one of the three Kindall brothers. Jerry, the oldest, 7 years older than I am. And my brother Wayne, who's 4 years older than I am. And as I like to tell them, by the time God got done bringing them into the scene, he finally got it perfect and I was born. And so I'm the third brother, which they called the little brother. Now that's an interesting name. But you know, as I grew up, I began to grow into a love and respect and admiration for my two older brothers. And in a sense, they had to really nurture those feelings in me, simply because all three of us slept in the same bedroom until Jerry entered the University of Minnesota. Now, of course, there were moments that these two brothers of mine had a little mischief in their mind, and they took advantage of me in order to have some fun. That's the role of little brothers. They're supposed to be there for that very purpose. And so they took advantage of it. Now, they were never mean, never cruel, never that way, but just sort of mischievous, you know how it goes? One experience out of the many, I like to say, would be one I think you would enjoy. I was about 4 years old, soon to go on to five, and I was sitting on the front steps of our house on Fuller Avenue in St. Paul. And Jerry and Wayne came up to me, and they knew I loved candy, and I'm not too sure which one of you said it, but I think it was both of you in the heart. You're blaming Jerry again, okay. And they said, Merrill, would you like to have a caramel? Oh, I love caramels. And so they gave me a caramel. I unwrapped it, put it in my mouth. I had never tasted anything so horrible and bitter in all of my life. They gave me a beef bouillon cube. Now, even though the memory of that had strayed from Jerry, and he claimed he didn't really remember it years later and we talked about it, I could really probably appreciate why he did, you know, as time goes on. Because you see, he wasn't the one sitting on the steps with a dissolving bouillon cube in his mouth. Made a big impression on me. But Jerry always made a big impression on me, as did my brother Wayne. God bless me with him. And above all, the three of us were privileged to be raised in a Christian home that nurtured the love and respect that we as brothers began to share in our own relationship. We had a delightful family, and I wish everybody could have had a family like this, for in the ministry I've seen some tragic scenes as far as families are concerned, some bitterness that has risen between brothers and sisters and parents and children. And yet God had blessed us in this way, and I hope we could be a blessing in those circumstances as well. We had our Grandpa Henry, who lived with us, my mother's father. He was a man who immigrated from Sweden in 1888, came over and raised a family of seven children along with his dear wife, our grandmother. And he was the kind of a fellow that could really model manhood for us in a special way, because he was gentle. He was selfless. He was caring. We loved our grandfather, and I know Wayne in particular had a special relationship with him, but we all had a special relationship with him. And we could see him in the living room or in the dining room, and there was his Swedish Bible, reading it. And, of course, he believed that Swedish was the language of heaven, so I hope Jerry's got it together by now. And he would say that. But he'd be praying for us boys and the rest of his children. And we knew he was praying for us. For his life action demonstrated that he cared in a very special way. And then there was our mother. Mother was an invalid and confined to a wheelchair. She had multiple sclerosis. She had constant pain in her legs, and it never left her for the many years that she suffered in that way. However, she never lost the gentle spirit that she had, the loving heart that made her try and go a little bit beyond what really she was capable of doing, just because she loved her family. And so he saw her in so many ways that said, "Boys, I love you." And certainly we began to love her back in a very special manner. And then there was our father. Butch, they called him. We couldn't call him Butch, but we did after he died. He loved to play pool, and matter of fact, that after his funeral, I don't know, some of you might remember this, we had the Butch Kindall pool tournament hours after we put him in the ground. But he was the kind of a fellow that, again, gave us some good examples to follow. Every morning, he would say something. He wouldn't sing, but he would say something. He'd stand at the foot of the steps and he would say, "Two bits, four bits, six bits a dollar, all getting up, stand up and holler." And out of that room that we shared together was a multitude of groans, really not wanting, but he wanted us to wake up to a cheery thought. And I guess we had to. He was the kind of a fellow who, Jerry Wayne got into trouble with him once. Well, maybe more than that, too. Every Sunday morning, he worked two jobs, 7 days a week. Monday through Friday at Royal Shade and Awning Company until noon or 1 o'clock in the afternoon. And then he'd come home between jobs that he had at the railroad where he worked from, it was Saturday through Wednesday. And he just had Wednesday, Thursday and Friday evenings off. But a model he set for us was on his one morning that he could just lay back in bed and relax and do nothing. Dad would get up before all the rest of us. He'd do our six blitz, all that kind of thing again, get us out of bed. But he'd always have breakfast ready for us, scrambled eggs with onions and bacon mixed in. It was good. He made sure that we had a good breakfast. And I'm sorry, Wayne, but it has to come out some way. There was one Sunday that Jerry and Wayne sort of complained about it. He didn't say much. Come the next Sunday, we all got up to the same cuisine. Mom and I and Grandpa and Dad had scrambled eggs with onions and bacon in it, and Jerry and Wayne had nothing except some raw eggs, a frying pan, and he says, "Here, you do it." And that was the last time you ever did it. But he also was a fellow that would wake up in the morning and do all of this and get us off to Sunday school with our grandfather, and who would sit at the dining room table and say, "Boys, boys," in his Swedish accent, "hurry up, Uncle Donald will be here any time." And Uncle Donald was always 10 minutes late. But that was okay, too. And he would begin to get Mother ready for his church. We'd get off to Sunday school, and he would take a roast and some vegetables and put in what we called the deep well in our stove. It was an electric stove. Today we'd call it a crock pot. Get all of that together, get her dressed and ready to go, and they'd take off for church every Sunday faithfully, the day he could have taken off and done nothing. But he taught us the importance of what it is to be men of God. And then there was our church, Elam Covenant, and it was a church that nurtured community and nurtured its children. We were part of a family, and we're forever grateful for that. And all of this left significant imprints on our lives and characters that today we still feel. Now, throughout our lives, it was not uncommon for Wayne and I to gain our identity by hearing. You know what I'm going to say, Wayne? "Oh, you're Jerry's brother, right?" Well, eventually we did get our own niche of identity, but, you know, I really enjoyed that. You know, Jerry, who gained so much achievement in athletics, I rather enjoyed basking in the glow of his glory and really enjoyed it. One backfired once, though, and that's the only time I can think of, is when I started my freshman year in high school. And the coach of the basketball and baseball team came up to me on that first day, and they said, "Oh, we're so glad to have you here. We have signed you up for the basketball team and the baseball team. We could hardly wait to get you out there for practice." But all I could say is the genes for those things were in my first two brothers, not me. So I went to track and ran. I loved running and did high hurdles and long jump and those things and did quite well. But I grew up admiring Jerry, his positive attitude. He always had that "we can do it" perspective, a tremendous sense of humor, yet a caring and encouraging heart. I remember in high school, as I was about 15, and I would be babysitting you, Betsy, our first niece. Oh, I thought she was fantastic, and she still is. So I was over there babysitting, and George and Jerry came home, and he was driving me home that evening, and finally he pulled into the parking lot of a small little strip mall not far from our house, and he turned to me and he said, "How you doing?" He knew that I was troubled over some things. I was struggling with things. We sat and talked until about 1 o'clock in the morning there, and Jerry shared his heart and embraced me with so much of his love. And it made a profound change in my life in that evening. And I praise God for it. I also saw him as a man who had integrity as far as his word was concerned. He was very self-disciplined as well. And that set the course for many of his achievements. Two examples of that. I remember that out on our lawn, which we had to cut from time to time, was a long dirt path. No grass grew on that, because that's where Jerry would go and practice sliding. And he'd keep going at it and going at it until he got sliding into base down to perfection. And then in the winter when he couldn't go outside, my dad had fixed up a T-ball set up in the basement of our house where he'd put the league ball on there, and he'd take a bat and he'd hit it. And at the other end, my dad had set up a big canvas tarpaulin that would take the concussion of that ball. And so we'd be upstairs and we'd hear crack, thud. It'd go on forever, it seemed. But it paid off. He was disciplined. And then his generosity was something I'll never forget. I took advantage of it big time. I had a 8-boy junior high softball team in Sunday school class. And I coached them, and we were out there every Saturday in the summer practicing and getting ready to play another church team. And so I had a contest with them one day, and I had a deal with our playing softball out there. And I said, "Jerry, could you get me an autographed baseball of all the Twins?" This was in 65 when they're down for the World Series. Well, yeah, sure. Now, that was one about 4 or 5 that he'd already done for me. Then come the clincher. "Date, could you get a bat? A baseball bat, and get all of their autographs on it." Oh, I thought that'd be great. What do you think what eBay would do with that today, you know? And all there. But I gave it to one of the boys who came out first, and the one who came out second, and the others. We all went out to the Dairy Queen. But he was willing to do that kind of thing and get us tickets to the game and so forth. And out of this, we began to see the great example of faith and values that formed his character. And became such a vibrant example, not only to myself, but his family, and so many of the rest of us. I've enjoyed in the last week reading the many accolades that have been published in the newspaper concerning Jerry and his character, and some of you are the ones that said those accolades. Accolades like he walked the walk, or he lived his life just as you're supposed to. He's an elite person. He lived life well. He was a gentle and a kind man of deep Christian faith. And his players mentioned this, he said, he taught us how to act and treat people. He wasn't just a coach. He taught us about life also. And he was a giant in the game of life. Another said he always did it the right way. while shaping the players into better human beings. He had a servant heart. He lived his life with faith and integrity. He served God. And first and foremost, Jerry was a God-loving man of faith and a man of his word that could be counted upon because he was wholesome and stuck to his values. A first-class person. As I read those, and I'm sure my brother Rain, I know, read quite a few, we both agreed that's true. When you've grown up with somebody, and you can hear all that and turn and say, yes, that's accurate, that's true. On the way from the airport on Monday when Wayne had picked us up to bring us into Phoenix, the morning we left the Twin Cities, it was 14 below zero. The high was 4 below zero. You people are gifted, and I hope you appreciate it. I really do. But I said, Wayne, what is the memory that you have of Jerry? And Wayne said, well, I used to tell people if they ever wanted to know what a godly man was like, look at our brother Jerry. And that's true. I just want to give a brief illustration here about maybe something that helps us better understand the motivating heart that he had. Beverly and I have had the privilege of traveling throughout Europe and also of taking 24 trips to what is called the Holy Land, Israel and Jordan, Egypt, over the years. And one of the places that we find very memorable is a very barren place. No trees, no grass, nothing growing there at all. It's a place called Wadi Kelt. Now, a wadi is a canyon that has been carved over the centuries by very sporadic rainfall. And slowly it has become carved. And Wadi Kelt was that kind of a canyon. It ran from the barren Judean hills east of Jerusalem, forming a deep watershed that ran dangerously down toward the Jordan River Valley and the oasis of Jericho and to the Dead Sea, the lowest place on earth. And over the millennia, the steep walls of that canyon have been baked solid by the sun. Now, as you look at it, you see some interesting things that I think can really impress something on your mind. You can see the narrow ancient pathways that line the sides of that deep canyon. And they just seem to cling, you know, to the side of those walls of the canyon. Very precarious. And those were pathways that were made over the centuries of time. And hikers love to take those pathways today. But a hiker had to be very careful that they only went single file and watched their step for fear of maybe slipping or tumbling and somehow getting some great injury or even death. And some of these pathways were formed in ancient times 3,000 years ago by a shepherd by the name of David in the Old Testament. And he would lead his sheep single file through these paths in the dry summers when there was no longer grass up by Bethlehem or Jerusalem, and he would take them down in those precarious ways and paths to green pastures and still waters down below. And so you picture this weather-beaten man taking those sheep and going down below, a man who cares more about his sheep than he does himself, a man who is in constant vigil in their behalf, never wanting any one of them to be hurt or be lost. And then the sheep who willingly followed after him. He didn't drive them, he led them. Now, Wadi Kelt is like this place, I think, that King David in the Old Testament had in mind when he wrote the 23rd Psalm that we read from earlier, because he was that kind of a shepherd who had to lead the sheep through that very place. And eventually that place became known as the Valley of the Shadow of Death because of the 23rd Psalm. For centuries it's been called that. And I'm sure that David looked at Wadi Kelt in those days as a contrast between his lived life, what he was going through in life, and what he trusted God would provide. And this is the substance of faith in God. That in our desperate moments when we are most in need, that God remains with us to provide for us and to get us through the situations of life. You see, God doesn't lift us out of the problems. He gets us through them as we trust in him with all our heart. As one who never leaves us nor forsakes us. And so Waddy Kelt speaks to our life reality today. For in moments of tragedy and grief and pain and loss, it may take more imagination than we can muster to believe that the existence is more than just parched and desolate place where there's no comfort. The New Testament in the book of Hebrews, it defines faith like this. Faith is assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things not seen. Now, I believe, like me, there are probably times in your life when you don't seem to have assurances. You don't seem to have convictions. They seem to have escaped you through the tremendous wall of all the problems that we might be facing in life. And it is there that Psalm 23 proclaims for us. We walk through the valley of the shadow of death and fear no evil. For what reason? He is with us. He never leaves us nor forsakes us. God is there, whether you want to believe it or not, whether you want to accept it or not. Faith is daring to believe that God walks with us even when we cannot feel his presence. Simply because faith is not feeling. It's an active, willful trust in something. And so faith is believing that even in such bleak landscape, God still presents himself. And faith is trusting, like the psalmist did in his words, confidence that he would bring him to safe pasture and to a life of eternity. Now, how do we weave Jerry into this? Let me close here. Our mother was a great coffee drinker. And she could never get coffee scalding hot enough to satisfy her. Her sister was the same way, and they'd get halfway through a cup of coffee and it'd have to be thrown away because it wasn't hot enough. Now it was at a temperature the rest of us could drink. Mom in her wheelchair one day when I was in high school, we sat at the table and having a cup of coffee. I always added water to it so it'd cool it off just like my dad did. And we're talking about life, and we're talking about Grandpa who had passed away not long before that. And she paused. You could tell there was a silence that needed to be respected. And then she looked up at me and she says, "You know, Merrill, I wouldn't trade this wheelchair for a healthy body, because it's in this chair I've discovered the grace and all sufficiency of my wonderful Savior, Jesus Christ." St. Francis de Sales has a quote that he made. He says, "The measure of love is to love without measure." And that's what Jerry and the rest of us have discovered in Jesus Christ. For who is he? He is God come in human flesh, pursuing us to bring us back unto himself. Do you realize that the Christian faith is the only one where we're not trying and striving to reach God? He didn't plan it that way. It's the only one where we discover God pursues us and seeks us as the shepherd does the sheep. There's a term that describes God's love. It's called agape, the Greek word agape. And what does it mean? It means you love the object of your love more than you love yourself. And you give yourself to it in that way. And that's exactly what Jerry discovered in Jesus Christ. And as he followed the shepherd, he became the fruitful life that many of you have known. Not because of him, but because of him. And if anything Jerry would want you to hear in this day would be the question, have you found the shepherd? Do you know Jesus Christ as your Savior? Have you discovered the power and the wonder of knowing him who accepts you fully as you are, and he knows you fully as you are? but he says, I've come to redeem you. All it takes is what Jerry did in high school, finally saying yes to Jesus Christ, who had long before said yes to him and loved us before we ever loved him. There's Jerry. And Jerry would love to meet you in heaven someday too. To him be the glory. Amen.
Some time ago, Jerry asked me if I would sing something at his funeral, whenever that was going to be. And it was long enough ago, so we had no perception of the fact it would be today. It's a song that's very special to us in our Swedish heritage. And it was sung at our grandfather's funeral, our mother's funeral, our father's funeral. It certainly will be sung at my funeral. And Meryl, you'd better have it sung at your funeral. After everything has been added up, and you look at the character of Jesus and what we've heard today, and the character of Jerry, more than anything else, I think Jerry wanted to be identified as a child of the Heavenly Father.
Children of the Heavenly Father, safely in His bosom gather, nestling bird nor star in heaven, such a refuge e'er was given. God His own doth tend and nourish, in His holy courts they flourish. From all evil things He spares them, in His mighty arms He bears them. Neither life nor death shall ever from the Lord His children sever. Unto them His grace He showeth, and their sorrows all He knoweth. Praise the Lord in joyful number, your protector never slumbers. At the will of your defender, every foeman must surrender. Trigorican, Ingvora, Ains good Lilia, born a scora, Sharnan Apo, Himla Feste, Pajane, Skananestet. Thank you, Jerry.
Our grandfather taught us the Swedish to that because it was the heavenly language. At least he thinks so. I'm not going to worry about it, but yet the power of that message is there. I'm sure Wayne and Kay, as well as Diane, or I should say George and Jerry, like us, saying that to our children many times. It was the lullaby we sang to them every night because we want to imprint upon them who God is, a Heavenly Father who nestles us in His care. Shall we stand? I have fought the good fight. I've finished the race. I've kept the faith. Now there is in store for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award me on that day. And not only to me, but to all who have loved and longed for his appearing. And so as you go this day, go in the cradling arms of Jesus Christ of God. Trust him, even though it's hard, because he's the one that will plant the faith in us and walk in the joy of his presence. Amen. The casket will be led out first, followed by the pallbearers and then the family. And you're all welcome to join us for a time of fellowship afterward and a time for us to get to know you better, too. God bless you. Amen.